everyone and submit. So about 4 weeks ago, there was plenty of data that may potentially indicate that the prices of used car vehicles were effectively flipping. And what I mean by flipping is the prices may perhaps come down. That said, as I've been in the market for a new or a used vehicle and have been visiting a lot of these dealership lots, what I've quickly come to realize is that is not necessarily the case. And the prices of a lot of these used vehicles is in fact going up. And for that matter, the amount of inventory that is in a lot of these dealership lots continues to get skimpier and skimpier every single day. So I wanted to validate this thesis that I have with some of the data that's potentially out there, and that's what I want to talk about in this video. But before I get too far into it, don't forget to smash that like button for the YouTube algorithm, subscribe to the channel, and ring that notification bell, and let's get into it. So when you're at these dealership sites and you're asking them the question, well, what in the world is actually going on? The answer is pretty much consistent across the board. What a lot of these dealerships will always say is that, hey, there's no new inventory, so the original equipment manufacturers, these are your Ford and your Chrysler and whatever else, they're basically not going out and producing enough vehicles so that these dealerships can basically have these vehicles on their lots. Therefore, when you do not have new inventory on these dealer lots, it basically has this trickle-down effect when it comes to used vehicles as well, which I'll talk about in a second here. So when it comes to vehicles that make their way onto dealer lots, there's really about five ways in terms of how these vehicles actually manifest themselves on those dealer lots, okay? So one of them is basically through leases, right? The second source is perhaps through some of these corporate fleet programs. The third way, which is kind of like infrequent at this point in time, is basically people trading in their vehicle. The fourth way in terms of how dealerships basically get their inventory on their lots is these original equipment manufacturers. Of course, under normal circumstances, they'll continue to pump out all of this inventory. And the fifth way is through rental car companies, right? So rental car companies at a certain point in time, they basically auction off their vehicles and the dealers basically buy those vehicles and put it on their lot. With that said, when it comes to 3 and 4, which is basically the OEMs producing vehicles as well as people trading in their vehicles, those are by far the biggest means with which inventory basically arrives at a given dealership. I've already talked about it, right? When it comes to those OEMs manufacturing their cars and all of that, well, that's just basically not happening, okay? A lot of dealerships, a lot of original equipment manufacturers have in fact cut off their production. They've basically closed down plants. They've closed down the number of shifts with which cars are basically produced. So the number or the amount of inventory that is basically making its way out to dealerships is just kind of like completely cut off. And this is being driven by the whole semiconductor shortage, which I've talked about in other videos and will include a link for in the description below, as well as up above, right around here somewhere. So when that is shot, right, people who basically have existing vehicles or used vehicles, they are not necessarily turning in their vehicles to buy new vehicles because there's not much inventory, right? So they're not gonna necessarily get what it is that they desire, right? So the amount of used car inventory that is on these dealership lots is therefore also getting completely slammed. Now, there's this big company called Cox Automotive, and what this company basically does is they provide a lot of data in terms of what is it that they're basically seeing in the industry, okay? And they will also will provide some forecasts in terms of what they see or what the expectation is in terms of what the sales volume is going to be for any given year. And some of the data that they basically published earlier in the year, right around June of 2021, was that they'll potentially see about 16.5 million vehicles basically getting sold. Now, since then, in August, they basically dropped that number to right around 13 million, and there's plenty of indication that would suggest that this number is forecasted number is going to drop to 11 million or a hair over 11 million. So needless to say, when there's no inventory, there's no point even talking about incentive. At this point in time, a lot of those incentives equate to about $2,424, which is actually significantly lower than what it has been historically. But then there are other forms of incentives as well, such as 0% financing, which is in fact very available at this point in time. Let's look at the data some more, right? During the last week of August, new sales were down about 38%, and when it comes to used car sales, they were down about 11%. What's interesting though is that even though this inventory is so low, the number of days that it takes for dealerships to get these vehicles off their lots is about average, okay? So there's a certain amount of time that it takes dealerships to basically cycle through their used car inventory. And when it comes to that amount of time, what is happening right now is it's basically about the same as it historically is, which is kind of an interesting fact pattern, right? Because we're talking about how there's absolutely no inventory, yet on the other side, I'm also saying that the amount of time that it takes for these dealerships to get these cars off the lot is about average. How would that basically be? And the only way that would effectively happen is if the demand is so dang low, right? If there's no demand for a lot of these vehicles, then you can basically get by with the amount of low inventory that you have on hand, and you slowly sell them off, and by the time you liquidate all of those vehicles, it basically arrives at that average number. Now, what's killing the demand, right? So one of the reasons there's so low demand is perhaps due to higher prices. So people are basically aware of this fact pattern and are therefore staying away from this whole used car market. That's perhaps one reason in terms of what's happening. Now, there's other trains of thought or schools of thought as well, such as the one produced by Kathy Wood of ARK Invest. So what she has basically suggested is during the global health crisis, a lot of people wanted to get away from public transportation and effectively buy vehicles to get them from point A to B. So basically, they bought a lot of those vehicles last year, so there's no compelling reason for them to buy a vehicle right now. And additionally, if they're looking to buy a new vehicle, then it's more compelling for them to potentially look at the electric vehicle market relative to the gasoline-powered market. Now, while there may be some truth to that, because the amount of electric vehicles continues to increase, and these reductions are primarily being seen on the gasoline-powered market, it's kind of like comparing apples to oranges for all intents and purposes, because the number of gasoline-powered vehicles sold is absolutely in the tens of millions, but when it comes to the number of electric vehicles sold, it's not as high, right? But anyway, what are your thoughts as it relates to that particular tape there? Definitely go ahead and include that in the comments below. Let's get back to the data, right? When it comes to the data, there's plenty of indications that would suggest that the prices are in fact going to go up, okay? Wholesale prices are up about 0.7%, and as I've mentioned in a prior video, it generally takes about 3 to 6 or 4 to 8 weeks for those prices to effectively move over to the retail market, okay? So right now, the retail prices are down about 0.1%. And this is largely due to the fact that about 4 weeks ago, there was some indication that the used car prices were basically flipping, okay? But now these wholesale prices are going up again, and these prices will transfer over to the retail market in the not too distant future. Now, one thing I've been spending a lot of time here talking about is demand. But there's this other concept called leads, okay? So when it comes to leads, it's basically people going online. They'll go to Kelley Blue Book, or they'll go to Auto Trader. They'll be researching vehicles, and that's what effectively drives leads. Now, it's not necessarily pure play demand, because you could have some casual browsers in that process as well. The goal, of course, is to eventually convert a lot of these leads into actual demand and then get the vehicles out the door. So it is a relevant metric, because a lot of OEMs, like the car manufacturers, they utilize those leads to see what it is that people are primarily interested in, and they'll manufacture the cars around those lines. And when it comes to dealerships, they're obviously interested in leads, generally speaking, as well. And when it comes to leads numbers, when you look at Auto Trader and Kelley Blue Book, net them out, it is quite high, okay? There's plenty of lead, there's plenty of interest when it comes to the market, but people are just not going about executing their purchases, because they effectively don't want to, either due to high prices or low inventory. One thing else that's kind of like this outlier factor that has made this whole paradigm somewhat interesting is, believe it or not, Hurricane Ida. I saw this article recently where a lot of states were basically getting crushed and getting flooded out due to the path that Hurricane Ida took, primarily in the state of New Jersey as an example. So a lot of those cars were, for all intents and purposes, totaled. And now there is going to be demand, artificial demand for that matter, for a lot of those residents in those flooded states to go ahead and buy either a new or a used vehicles. So in the short term here, we may see some artificial demand in a lot of the states that were basically impacted by the path of Hurricane Ida. What's the gist of all of this, right? Leads are high, demand is low, inventory is low, prices are high, incentives, some of it is okay, but they're not necessarily that great either. So for all intents and purposes, if you have the opportunity to wait and can get by with your existing vehicle or no vehicle at all, then the right action would be to basically not go ahead and buy a new or a used vehicle. A lot of the automotive manufacturing companies have basically come out and they say that some of the semiconductor or chip shortage will resolve itself in 2023. So we're over a year and a half out for basically some of that to happen. Now, but if you don't necessarily have a choice, right, there's certain rules that you can always maintain in terms of determining or buying a car or determining how much of a car that you can afford. For example, there's this whole rule called 24-10, right? Which basically means that you should be able to put 20% down on the vehicle. You should not finance the vehicle for over 4 years. And of course, when it comes to that 10 numbers, basically that the vehicle should not, or the monthly payments on your vehicle should not exceed 10% of your gross income. Some people even change those numbers slightly and to make it 23 and 8, so 20% down, 3 year financing terms, and 8% of your gross income on a monthly basis. And of course, if you talk to some financial experts or you listen to a lot of their videos, such as Dave Ramsey, they'll basically come out and say that your vehicle purchase should not exceed 50% of your gross income. So there's a variety of different ways in terms of how you can kind of like arrive or derive how much of a car you can afford if you do need to in fact buy a car in these kind of like bleak time. So hopefully you enjoy the contents of this video. Hopefully a lot of this data makes sense. I'll of course provide an update next month when more data is released in terms of where this market is potentially headed. So definitely subscribe, ring that notification bell, and I will see you in the next one.